Hi, everybody, and welcome to Heel Heat. My name is George Coles, and on this episode, we're doing It Came From the Network. The topic of this It Came From the Network, WWF Monday Night Raw from March 26, 2001, marked on Peacock as Season 9, Episode 13. If you watched my It Came From the Network from last week, we covered the WCW Nitro on the same night, which was the last Nitro. So as a bookend, we're going to cover this as well to see what was done on this half of the simulcast. If you've never seen my shows before, I grade everything on a 1 to 5 scale. 1 is the worst, 5 is the best. I'm going to kind of speed run through this because there's a lot of segments on the show. I'm only going to grade the matches. The segments I'm going to talk about all as part of the show at the end. So let's get ready for this. It's probably going to be a quick speed run through a lot of this. We start off with Vince McMahon in the back, and he's looking at two monitors. One has WWE. The other has WCW with a Jeff Jarrett match, which Jeff Jarrett wasn't even wrestling on Nitro that night. If you watched when I talked about this on the last video, I mentioned remembering Vince firing Jarrett, and I thought it happened on the WCW show, but this is where it happened. So I do remember that correctly, I just remembered it from the wrong show. He basically says that Jeff Jarrett's G-O-N-N-E-E. A takeoff on Jeff Jarrett spelling his name. We'll see that as a running thing through the night, Vince McMahon trashing WCW talent, which he probably had gripes with at the time. That's followed up with an in-ring segment with Kurt Angle, who's basically saying he doesn't have a match for WrestleMania. For my longtime viewers, you know what I'm about to say here. I do not condone or respect Chris Benoit in any way for the way his life ended. I do have to cover him because he is such an important part of WWF / WWE in the time. So take that with a grain of salt. I'm going to try and look at it as much as I can in a vacuum. Benoit comes out, basically puts a challenge for WrestleMania for him and Angle, which is 6 days later. Gets Angle to tap to the crossface, which Paul Heyman on commentary said never happened before. I don't remember if that's true or not, but I tend to believe it was. Edge and Christian come out basically to set up an angle for later on with Angle and Edge and Christian against Benoit and the Hardy Boys. Then we get another backstage segment with Vince McMahon. I'm just going to call him Vince for the rest of this to make it easier. He has Trish Stratus with him. They're watching Lex Luger and Buff Bagwell, which he talks a little bit of crap about both of them. Then we get Michael Cole trying to get an interview with Deborah McMichael, who at the time was managing The Rock, but also married to Steve Austin. She kind of walks away from that. Then we finally get to our first match of the show. We get Taz versus Val Venus. Val Venus is in full Right to Censor mode. This is a lumberjack match. The rest of Right to Censor is at ringside. For Taz, he has the APA. And also Jacqueline. This match was a little bit too quick for my liking. Taz does pick up the win here. I'm giving this a 3. Then we get another segment in the back with Vince and Trish Stratus again. This time it's Road Warrior Animal. Again, makes a comment about Animal. Then we get a match with William Regal. It's a tune-up match for his match with Jericho at WrestleMania 17. He's going to face one of the Holly family. Both Crash and Molly Holly come out. Crash starts to get ready, but Regal drags in Molly, basically saying it was Molly, not you. The whole time in the crowd, there was a Doink who was going to be in the gimmick battle royal at WrestleMania 17. Doink comes in. It turns out to be Chris Jericho. He puts Regal in the Walls of Jericho. This is one of my favorite segments of the time. I really enjoyed this. I enjoyed this much like I did with the DDP and La Parka thing. For some reason, this will always get me. I always buy in on these. I always love the gimmick. I loved it when Jericho did it with Pentagon as well. I thought that was all phenomenal. They didn't really say who the winner of the matches basically got thrown out. It really doesn't matter. Attitude Era matches matter is about as much as the number of Burger King McNuggets you've eaten over your lifetime, or McDonald's McNuggets. I know Burger King just does nuggets. Anyway, I'm giving that a 5. I thought it was highly entertaining. Then we get another segment with Vince and Trish. This time they trash Dustin Rhodes. He goes into the Gold Dust wanting to have fake boobs and then starts to be lecherous, which again, I mentioned this last week when these kept coming up on the WCW show. Kind of uncomfortable watching the Trish and Vince interaction, knowing the lawsuits that went on last year and the payoffs he had and the stuff with the paralegal, kind of uncomfortable watching this back. Then we get an interview with Regal and the coach. Regal basically says that later on tonight, Jericho is going to have a match, but he's going to go up against the Big Show because William Regal is the commissioner. He can make matches. We go to another backstage segment. It's Angle, Edge, and Christian basically talking up their six man they're going to have later. Edge and Christian introduce Angle to Rhino, who had debuted on the Thursday night SmackDown show the week before. Then we get a replay of a sit-down interview from that same SmackDown with Steve Austin and The Rock being moderated by Jim Ross. Again, they did such a wonderful job of leading into WrestleMania. There were a lot of coming in and out of breaks, a lot of hype videos for this match, one of the big matches of all time. They played the Limp Bizkit My Way song all throughout the night with those hype videos. This here, just phenomenal. We get another segment where this time the coach is trying to interview Deborah. She basically blows him off. Then we get Vince McMahon with Trish Stratus. He asks her to give him some good luck, which they kiss. And then Vince comes out to the ring. The one thing that was a little different here than on the WCW side, Vince came out early, so to make up for it, in character, he thought on his feet, and I thought this was awesome. He told Lillian to reintroduce himself because the fan didn't give him a good enough reaction. This was awesome. Again, I'm going to speed through this part because I already covered it last week more in depth. Vince does his thing, talks bad about some WCW wrestlers. Finally, we get Shane on the Tron. Shane says, "I'm the one that bought WCW." Fantastic segment, one of the most iconic segments in Monday Night Raw and WCW Nitro history. One of those things that's burned into my memory as a wrestling fan. This is one of the most iconic nights in wrestling history. After that, we come back to what had been after the commercial break. Vince is angry, yelling at his lawyers on the phone. Then we go into the six-man match. Matt and Jeff Hardy with Chris Benoit going up against Kurt Angle, Edge, and Christian. Hardys have Lita with him. Team Eck has Rhino with them. This breaks down. The Hardys and Benoit pick up the win. Rhino gores Lita at the end of this, showing his ruthlessness, his ruthless aggression, if we're going to coin a phrase that came a couple years later. This was awesome. Again, the Hardys and Benoit pick up the win. I'm giving this one a 4. That's followed by a promo with Undertaker and Kane. Taker's talking about Triple H busting him open, getting him stitched, setting up their match for WrestleMania. Then next up, we get another match. It's Test versus X-Pac with Eddie Guerrero as the guest referee. Albert is out with X-Pac. They were part of X-Factor at the time. The one thing that really stood out here is even here, where they weren't fully getting behind Eddie Guerrero as a company, the fans were so eating out of the palm of his hands. Everything he did, he's so charismatic and so gifted, and he had a quality that fans just gravitated to. Ultimately, Albert and Eddie Guerrero get involved. X-Pac picks up the win. I thought this was awesome. I'm giving this a 4. We get a segment backstage where the interviewer tries to interview Austin and he just kind of stares at him. That's sawed up with another surprise. Mick Foley comes to the ring. Vince comes out. Vince says, "Hey, I'm gonna get you arrested. You're trespassing." Here's another iconic moment from this night. Mick Foley points to the Titantron where a video is played from when he was commissioner and Linda McMahon is signing a bunch of paperwork, basically giving him permission to do things. One of those things is he gets to referee one of the matches at WrestleMania, any match that he wants to. And guess what, Vince? That's going to be your match against Shane McMahon. Just another awesome segment on the night. And we'll talk about this at the end, especially this last half. We get another angry Vince McMahon in the back. This time he throws around some food, some strawberries. Then we go into our match with Chris Jericho versus the Big Show. This one was a little bit off the rails for me. Almost right off the bat, Kane gets involved, and then Raven gets involved, and William Regal get involved. For all of the good segments in the Attitude Era, there was not so good as well. And what I mean by that is, this wasn't bad. It's just if we didn't see constant interference throughout the whole night, and this wasn't basically a throwaway match, this would have been better. I would have liked to seen a Chris Jericho Big Show match at this time with the talent that both of these guys had that went 15 minutes and this 3 minutes schmoz of a match. Ultimately, Big Show picks up the win. I'm giving this one a 3. We get to see The Rock. He's going down the hallway looking for Steve Austin. One of the people backstage shows him where. We almost get it and it doesn't matter what your name is, but he cuts himself short. That's followed up with the Dudley Boys at WWF New York hyping up their TLC match. And if you're not familiar with WWF New York, it was a restaurant that WWE had in Times Square, and they would send wrestlers there, and they would be there for Raws or Sunday Night Heat, or even during the pay-per-view pre-shows or during the pay-per-view. They would host watch segments from there. From what I understand, I never got a chance to make it there. The food was not great, and it was very overpriced, and the memorabilia there was all overpriced, so it went out of business. That followed up with a backstage segment with The Rock and Steve Austin, basically saying in their tag team match later, if you don't screw me, I won't screw you. That leads right into the main event, The Rock and Steve Austin versus Undertaker and Kane. And like I said, there was so much they did right on the show. I'm going to talk about it here after the match. This is a really fun match. Again, Triple H comes out and gets involved. Another match with interference. A little bit of the burnout. You kind of forgive it because of the high level of talent here. Rock and Austin pick up the win. Afterwards, Undertaker goes after Triple H. The Rock stuns Steve Austin, takes some of his Bush NA beer and leaves, and basically gives him a toast on the way out. Just a great way to go off of the air. I'm giving that match a 4. Overall, I thought this was highly entertaining. Almost every segment on here was great. There are some of them that have been indelibly burned into my memory. Obviously, the Vince and Shane buying of WCW, Mick Foley coming back, Chris Jericho disguising himself as Doink, Jeff Jarrett being fired right off of the bat. I was a Jarrett fan, so that kind of made me a little bit angry. Seeing the litany of Hall of Famers that were on this show is something I did want to bring up. At the end of the Vince and Shane segment that was on both Nitro and Raw, Jim Ross points out the main event, which is going to be Rock and Austin versus Taker and Kane, and it's on TNN, and he repeats it 2 or 3 times so the viewers might come over and watch that, which I thought was so fantastic. It's such a little thing that you don't think of, but they did it here. And from that point, I'm just going to put from that point on, here's the star power that came on the show, and I'm going to name everybody. You had Vince McMahon, Matt and Jeff Hardy, Chris Benoit, Kurt Angle, Edge and Christian, Lita, Rhino, Undertaker and Kane, Test and X-Pac, Eddie Guerrero, Albert, Steve Austin, Mick Foley, Chris Jericho, Big Show, Raven, William Regal, The Rock, The Dudley Boys, Triple H. The heavy majority of the people I mentioned there are in the Hall of Fame, other than Rhino, Benoit, and Test, and Albert, and Jericho, but Jericho will be in there. That's a given. Regal will be in there too, that's a given. Raven's not as well, that's another one that's not. But just look at the high level of talent from when they switched over to where the WCW fans might have came over and watched it. Just look at what they put on here. Building to WrestleMania, one of their high shows of the year, one of the best WrestleManias of all time. Just astounding how they built this show. And the beginning half wasn't bad either. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying it was. Just saying they loaded this back of this card, so if they had new eyes, they may hook them into coming in. This show was fantastic. I loved everything on here. Most of the matches were enjoyable. They were short, but also enjoyable. My preferred match would have been the WCW style, which they gave them a little bit more time, around 10-15 minute matches. Still the style I like now. I like a little bit longer of a match with a little bit less story. But the way the stories were progressing here, the Austin and Rock feud, the purchase of WCW, Vince McMahon's abuse of power. Everything about this was fantastic. Overall, I'm going to give this show a 5. I would probably put this in my top 5 or 10 Monday Night Raws of all time, which is saying something because I know they're over 1,000 or 1,500. I don't even know what the number is anymore. But they've been on the air for 30 years, so whatever that is, it's that many. Just an outstanding show. From top to bottom, when you look at the good of the Attitude Era, this is what you would point to. There's some bad. There's definitely some cringeworthy stuff. Not so much on this show, other than the Vince stuff and obviously Benoit being a piece of garbage. They managed to not have some of the other cringy stuff, like the hand being born or Sammy, the love interest of Mark Henry, who at the time was very edgy. If they tried that now, they would get ran off of TV. If you know what I'm talking about, you know exactly why. This was fantastic from top to bottom. I rather enjoyed it. Like I said, I'm giving it a 5. With that being said, let's smash that like button, share the video, subscribe if you haven't. If you see that join button, that's how you become a member. Becoming a member definitely helps out the page, helps me to fund the show, to get better equipment, to get new equipment, to replace some equipment that might be going bad. I'd definitely appreciate it if you looked at that and possibly became a member. There are some perks. Most like every other channel, you'll get a shout out. You'll get preferential treatment in the comments. You'll get little emojis. There'll be member exclusives once we have some members. But I digress. With that being said, if you made it all the way to the end, let me know who your favorite legend on the show was, whether it be Austin, The Rock, Undertaker, Kane, Kurt Angle, any of these guys. It doesn't even have to be any of those. It could be Taz, could be Val Venus. Let me know who your favorite legend on the show was. Put it down here in the comments. With all that being said, my name is George Coles, and it's been another It Came From the Network.